So, thanks for joining on today's meetup on runtime analysis for AUTOSAR embedded projects. My name is Florian Sommer, and with me today here is my colleague Sebastian Ziegler. Myself, I'm manager of the business development for the product line embedded software here at Vector Informatik. And my colleague Sebastian is a product engineer who is working a lot on tracing topics with classic and adaptive microSAR. And we are here today to give you an introduction and an overview on some different topics. First of all, in the first part of the session, we will start with a general introduction into scheduling trace measurements, and to give you a general understanding of what we are talking about and with which kind of traces we are working here in this webinar. Then we will switch to tracing in AUTOSAR classic platforms. We will show you which technical necessities we see from a hardware perspective, and we will also show you what kind of software you need to use in order to extract such scheduling traces, including the configuration within the DaVinci configurator, and also some examples on how debugger trace vendors handle these kind of topics to do the measurements. Then we're going to switch to tracing in AUTOSAR adaptive platforms, also with the same structure. So we will start on a hardware level, show you what you need there, and go step by step up through the different layers of the OS and also adaptive AUTOSAR, so that you can see which kind of trace techniques can be used there. That will be the part that we are doing here based on a presentation. Afterwards, for the next three topics, the evaluation of timing-related requirements based on scheduling traces, we will switch over to a live demonstration of the Timing Architects tool suite. This is a tool that we are using here at Vector and that we also provide to our customer to do analysis of such scheduling traces that have been recorded. So we will show you how you can work with these traces once you have recorded them and what kind of information and benefits you get out of there. Then part of this demonstration will also be how you can predict the real-time behavior based on the simulation, even if you don't have an actual hardware available. So this will help you in very early stages of the project. And in the last part of the demonstration, we will then show you how you can do all the steps that will be done here manually, how you can automatize these and integrate such tracing and analysis of the scheduling trace within your CI environment and automatically generate reports dedicated to your projects so that you always have an overview and you can track continuously the dynamic behavior of your ECU. And in the end, we will have some information how you can get in touch if you need further information or if you want to test these solutions. Good. Then let's start with the general introduction on the scheduling measurement. First of all, we want to start with a short idea on what can happen if you don't take care of timing related requirements. We have here an example of a customer project, which was a gateway ECU, which had all non-preemptive tasks. And in certain circumstances, the project has seen deadline misses of tasks, which led to a functional failure of the ECU. And by analyzing the scheduling trace in the tooling, it was possible to find out that actually the reason for the failure, the functional test failure of this ECU, was that there was a high ISR load during the time window where the failure happened. And what helped here was basically aligning the offsets of the different tasks in the system And that was enough and helped to reduce, to get rid of this functional test failure. And that's the thing we see actually quite often, that a lot of projects are running into functional failures, but have a very, very hard time to find out what actually happened at this point in time in a certain task or also runnable. And this is something that's actually quite surprising, because what you see quite often is that the people in the projects are, if they're using some measurements like RTM, which allows you to get runtime measurements, so general statistical information about the minimum, maximum, and average runtime of tasks, that's already quite advanced. In many cases, what you see is that simply within the idle task, a pin of the microcontroller is toggled, and this is what indicates the CPU load to these projects. And as long as you don't have a problem with your CPU load, this might be an okay solution. But latest, if you really have an issue and you're running into a phase where you have a very high load of 99% or something like this, then only knowing that you have the problem is not helping you to solve it. And this is where scheduling traces can be really, really helpful, because it gives you a really detailed insight into the actual behavior of your ECU. Now, I've been talking about statistics, about scheduling traces, and I just see the screen is frozen on the first page still. I hope not. So I can see the chat if it's still frozen. So you should see now three gray boxes. Okay, still frozen. Okay, then let me test if we can stop the presentation and just reshare it. Maybe that will help. Okay, it's loading again. Let's see. Ah, yes. Okay, perfect. Thanks for the hint, and sorry for taking so long to notice this. I have now, in a couple of seconds, you should see it. So now I will just go back to the slide that I was presenting about the runtime problems. Basically, what I wanted to say, and what's the main part of this picture that I gave to you, it would be good in many cases to have a detailed insight with such a scheduling trace that is shown here on the top right for different projects, which allows you to investigate in much more detail what happened at which point in time with which task. Compared to only knowing that you have a very high CPU load, for example, or only knowing that you have a functional test failure in this or in another ECU without having this kind of information available. So with respect to the different possibilities that you have when it comes to real-time analysis, you can see these three gray boxes here. And this can be interpreted as the outer box always includes all the information from the inner box. So the basic possibilities you would have is sampling. So you can get the utilization of the CPU, for example, by sampling. So this gives you very limited information, similar to what I was describing before by having a look at the idle task of your OS. The next possibility, the next level that provides a little bit more insights, but is also not quite as detailed, is statistics. This is something you can do in case you're using a vector microSAR stack for your AutoSAR projects. What we offer there is a module called VRTM, Runtime Measurement. It's included in the AutoSAR monitoring and debugging cluster of the AutoSAR stack. And this module allows you to extract the minimum, maximum, and average timing metrics and also exact CPU utilization from your target hardware. So basically what you do is you tell this module via XCP to measure a certain task for a certain period. So for example, task A for 2 seconds. And every time this task A is getting activated, a timer is started. And every time the task A is terminated, the timer is stopped. So you always have the time from start to terminate. And this will give you, then you will get back from the RTM the minimum and maximum and average runtime of this task. So this is already quite helpful compared to having only the information available, how high is my CPU load. So you already have some runtime information in there. But what you do not know in this case, since you only know the start and the termination point, you have no idea what actually happened in between. For example, has the task that after it was activated, did it start running immediately? Or was it waiting to get resources on the CPU for a couple of milliseconds? And also, once it was activated, was it actually running through and running all the time? Or was it preempted for 50% of its time? And this kind of information, this is what you get if you measure the actual timeline with a profiler. And based on this, you can really get very exact data about the start delay, for example, in your tasks. You can see how long was the preemption and so on. So that's way more detailed. And this is basically what you need if you really need to dig into the detail. Now, on the next page, let me give you a general idea about how these scheduling traces, what's contained in them, what kind of information can you find in there. So now what you can see here is different states that can be taken by our tasks or assigned to a task by the microSAR OS. And what you have here is basically the different states. You have a running state, you have a preempted state, activated and suspended state. And what the scheduling trace does, you configure the OS hooks for the tasks that you're interested in the microSAR OS. And then the scheduling trace simply provides in the BTF format. BTF stands for best trace format. It's just a format where you have in a CSV always a specific row of information. So you always have a time stamp, you have the entity, so which task, and you also have the state transition in there. And what you will get by this when you are running a task is basically you get the information a task is activated at the timestamp 1 millisecond. Then at the timestamp 2 millisecond, this task got actually started since it's run in the running state now. And at the time 3 milliseconds, this task is now getting preempted. Since there is another task who's getting activated at this point in time, which has a higher priority on this core. Then we go back to running, and later at 5 milliseconds, this task is then now terminated. And that's basically what you get if you have such a scheduling trace on a task level. And if you compare this now, this detailed information to what you get with a runtime measurement, or if you have only the statistics, you would only see with a statistics measurement that you have here a runtime of 5 milliseconds, but you cannot see that there was a start delay, and you can also not see that actually this task was preempted for 1 millisecond. So it's way detailed, way more detailed than you would expect this, or that than you know this from pure statistical approaches. So if we have a look at the tool chain that you would need in order to do something like this, of course, don't be irritated. So here it's always MicroSAR, since we are from Vector and our AutoSAR stack is MicroSAR, but I'm sure also other vendors have similar possibilities to configure trace hooks in the OS and RTE. Just to mention that. But from now on, when I'm talking about this, I will talk about the tool chain that we are using here in these examples. And this is MicroSAR. With MicroSAR, you have the possibility to use the DaVinci configurator to configure the OS and RTE hooks. Then you will have your project on your ECU and use a trace debugger to extract the runtime information. So you have different possibilities. We are working here quite closely with iSystem and Lauterbach to support such measurements. You can also use traces measured by PLS and by Gliwa. And you can also utilize the VX1000 from Vector in order to measure such scheduling traces. Now, all these trace debugger solutions will in the end provide you a scheduling trace, which contains the information that I showed you one slide before. So all the state changes of the different tasks. And this trace can now be imported into the Timing Architects tool suite that you will see live in a couple of minutes. And here you will be able to analyze the trace that has been measured against predefined requirements. So for example, such requirements could be very generic requirements. For example, if you say, okay, in my company, we want that all the ECU projects that we do shall not exceed a CPU load of 70% on each core. This would be an example for a generic requirement. You could also go on a very specific level of task and also on a runnable and say, okay, if we have now tasks that are scheduled in a periodic way, if we have this, we would, of course, want to make sure that actually a task that where we expected that it's scheduled with a period of five milliseconds, that between two activations with a certain jitter, which is to be expected, this task will be activated every 5 milliseconds. So this is something you can put in as a requirement into this tool and evaluate against the trace, so that you will get a feedback whether your schedule that you have defined is actually kept or not. And the same is true for deadlines. So let's stay with periodic tasks. If you have a periodic task with 5 millisecond period, of course, the task should definitely not exceed its period in runtime. So this is something you can define here and say, okay, I want to have a critical and a warning requirement at 90 and 80% of the period of this task, for example. That's something you can define. And also there are more advanced and more detailed things available, like event chains, for example. Let me give you an example on this. If you would have three tasks, one task is reading sensor data, one task is processing the sensor data, and then there's a third task doing an action, making a decision and doing an action for an actuator based on the data he gets. Then you would first of all want to make sure that this event chain read, process and act. This event chain is actually kept and executed in order. And as a second thing, of course, you want to make sure that this happens in a certain time frame. So you want to make sure, for example, this happens within 1 millisecond, for example. Then you can define an event chain like this and put a timing requirement to this event chain, which then can also automatically be checked against such a trace, and the report can be generated. Okay, so much about the general introduction on this topic and the general idea about the scheduling traces and what kind of possibilities this offers to you and your projects. Now we will switch over to the tracing in classic platforms and afterwards to adaptive platforms. And with that, I hand over to my colleague Sebastian.
Hi, thanks Florian. Hello everybody, this is Sebastian speaking. I'm giving you an introduction to tracing and actually what's the technical background behind that and what do we understand as tracing in this case. Okay, starting with the first slide. So I might want to give a rough overview about what kind of hardware trace techniques are available. So by hardware trace techniques, I'm speaking about trace messages, which can be generated by an most of the time evaluation device of a processor. And this ECU processor can generate a message when something is happening on the core. For example, a program flow instruction or instruction trace message. This message can be triggered or exported from the ECU when an instruction pointer change, for example, has happened. As you see here in this case, it says there's an instruction where it has jumped to this address.
Wait a second. We have an issue with the screen here.
Okay, thanks.
Maybe you can stop and restart the sharing. There's only a dark screen right now.
Okay. I think I start completely fresh from the sharing. I'm going to start the desktop sharing again. There should be at least in the Skype window now a presentation slide.
Nope, not yet. Just a second. Wait.
Okay, keep me updated as soon as it's available in the stream window.
Now it's loaded and you can continue.
Okay. Then.
Stop. Okay, now you go. Sorry.
Okay. Thanks, Florian. Okay, guys, let's continue with the tracing, the hardware trace techniques, basic knowledge in this case. So I was speaking about program flow trace. That means when an instruction pointer is doing something, this is most of the time hardware vendor specific and ECU specific. Therefore, I try to be a little bit general. So when some assembly are executed, then the ECU can generate this message. And this is what you see here. You see, there is an instruction message. It's the green one. There was a jump execution to the symbol of the header file oscore_h in line 366 at a certain timestamp. And the message was triggered by a certain trace unit. Okay, this trace technique is pretty interesting when it comes to getting a really deep insight into each assembly, I might say, and you want to actually understand what has happened before an error. However, it's in some cases you might need to mix it with other trace techniques in order to extract those OS information. As Florian explained previously, the state changes of the task, for example, are OS context information and not always available on assembly level. That means you can use program flow trace as a trace technique which is not interfering into the system. That's the beautiful part about it. It doesn't interfere into the system. The controller generates the message itself and exports it via any trace interface from the target or stores it in an emulation memory. The same kind of message can be created from a data variable access. That's what you see here. There is an OS information variable, which is called OS config trace, core zero dynamic. And when it writes to it, you can trigger this kind of message and the timestamp is also being added to the message. That means show read and write access to a variable with a timestamp, and it can be used, that's what we are going to do later, to trigger trace messages if you are adding some, I might say, data trace variables to the system in order for you to extract what you want to see. And this goes a little bit into the direction of this so-called, some call it instrumentation-based trace approach. So typically some of those ECUs have an own register set where you write to, and this writing to this register set triggers the message. That means you cannot trigger a trace message by writing to any kind of data, but writing to a specific set of registers triggers the message. Okay? How can we utilize those kind of hardware trace techniques? Let's go to the next slide. There are technical preconditions on the hardware tracing mechanisms, and I would like to give you an example on the Infineon RX Tricore in this case, quite commonly used ECU. And all of those evil devices, they also have these trace capabilities most of the time. That means, let's having a look at this Tricore of the second generation with 6 cores. So those areas should symbolize the 6 cores. And below you see the so-called MCDS, which is the multi-core debug solution. That's what Infineon calls their trace mechanism. And you could see that there are 6 cores and 3 so-called processor observation blocks. Each of those processor observation block can trigger a data or this instruction trace message. Now, if you would like to trace all the cores together with all the task states and runnable states, you might need to be a little bit, I might say, clever in order to get all this information, because you cannot set each of those processor observation blocks to all the cores, because it's only 3 and there are 6 cores available. Therefore, what we do in this case is we use a certain trace variable, which is symbolized here in this area. So there is, for example, the local memory unit where all the cores can write to, or this older memory area, which is kind of a dedicated area just to write to and not store anything. It's just a null memory where you can write to, and this triggers a message if you configure the bus observation block. Okay? That means, in other words, each of the cores just writes when it schedules a task. It writes it into the trace variable, and this triggers via the bus observation block the trace message. What's the benefit of this purpose? The benefit is the trace variables is accessible for all the cores. So you don't need to be limited in the cores you want to see. You only write the information of what you're interested in into the trace variable. That means you save a lot of trace bandwidth because you only trigger a message when you actually really would like to see it. And you only would need to store, to write the information, but it's actually never buffered or anything like that. It's a kind of a hybrid approach, what we use in this case, because we trigger the hardware trace mechanisms with using software instrumentation. How is this approach also a very, I might say, applicable approach also for auditor systems? I think this will be get a little bit more clear on the next page. So let's have a look at the AutoSAR stack from an OS and virtual functional bus tracing view in the AutoSAR Classic platform. So what do you see here? You see the software components having a runnable entity, in this case, two software components and two runnables, just for the sake of easiness. The runtime environment as an implementation for the virtual functional bus and the OS. So now there are also basic software modules, and you would like to see in your project which basic software main function is running, what runnables are running, which tasks are running when they are preempted, and you would like to see it on all the cores, right? Therefore, we utilize this OS and RTE scheduling trace points or scheduling hooks. That means having a look at this OS configuration. There is an application task in the easy example and the basic software task. The scheduling between both of them can be done with the schedule point. That means the schedule point or the schedule hook writes to this trace variable shown in the first place. If a runnable now is triggered in the task, the trace point of the virtual functional bus is also writing to this trace variable and indicates now runnable one is going to start. And the runnable returns and the hook also indicates this. Now, the OS decides to schedule on the basic software. That means it triggers the schedule point, writes again to the trace variable, and you trigger main function, again will be indicated, and so on. That means you get tracing on a software architectural level. If you compare this, for example, to this instruction trace mechanism, then you have way less information because you have millions of assembly between all of those instructions, right? Your application task can have a lot of assembly instructions and your main function, but you actually only trigger when those software architectural entities are starting or terminating. Yeah, that means you can see runnables, main functions, and you can see a view about the software architecture with their runtime behavior. How does this actually look from a code side? How does this instrumentation variable needs to be utilized? Having a look at this slide. We signal this task state changes, right? The scheduling and the runnable execution for a task state change. There is not much information actually which needs to be added to the trace variable. It's the core ID, so you know at which core was the scheduling, the task ID, and the state the task is changing to. You see this here? There's an extract of the OS activation hook, which writes down which task was scheduled and which core. And all of this information is decoded into the variable. They store it, they write it to this trace variable, this triggers the hard trace mechanism, and you might want to know now what kind of overhead does this have, how much do I actually interfere into the system. The nice part is it's actually only this atomic write access. So on the Infineon RX example, this would be a 32-bit variable, and that's it. You only write 32 bits into a register, and that's the overhead. The hook macro is efficient, so you don't have overhead by any function calling. And with that approach, you can always, even if the system is overloaded on all the 6 cores, you don't have the trouble that this instrumentation will not be executed, because the writing to a variable can always be done, even if it's delayed. That's basically a good overview about the classic platform trace mechanisms. Now, how do I enable those mechanisms? In the DaVinci Configurator, the configuring tool for the basic software from Vector, you have this so-called runtime system general view on the left-hand side. For the users who are already familiar with that tool, you can enable this on the runtime system general. You get information about OS and virtual functional bus. And at this point in time, you add the header, which includes this trace instrumentation. After the next OS generation, your instrumentation is already added. That's it. Typically, those hooks are provided by the trace vendor. That means Lauterbach, iSystem, Cleaver, PLS provide different kind of hooks. And you can always add them in the same dialog over here. Switching on to the virtual functional bus tracing view. For the virtual functional bus, it's a little bit more complicated, I might say. You can still operate in the same runtime system general view. You would enable the VFB tracing, but now you need to select which kind of runnable you would like to add. For the OS, it's quite simple. You add one hook, and since the OS schedules all the tasks centralized, you do not need to add specific hooks for task A or B or C. It's done in one place. In OSIC systems, it was kind of the same with the pre and post task hooks. Now, for the virtual functional bus, you would need to add a runnable return and the start hook to the RTE generation. And when the RTE is generated, the RTE generator will add those function calls before and after the runnable or main function start and return. That's it. That's everything you would need to do in order to equip your ECU project with such kind of a measurement tooling. Now, moving on, how does tracing look in AutoStar adaptive platforms? So tracing in AutoStar adaptive platforms is a little bit more advanced, and there are actually the same kind of mechanisms available. We are explicitly looking here at an ARM-based hard rate trace support. We are also looking at the...
Okay, I think we have a frozen screen again. No, okay. No, it was just a little bit delayed. Now it's fine. You're on the right page again. Sorry.
Thanks. No worries. So we should be good to go with the ARM-based hard rate trace support. Okay. So what we learned in the classic platform that the trace mechanism for those ECUs is typically equipped with either instrumentation, so instruction trace mechanisms or data trace mechanisms, or those software-based trace mechanisms. So in this case, it's kind of the same, but imagining an Renesas V3H air car, you have a lot of cores and a lot of different cores. You have Cortex-A cores, Cortex-M cores, and each of them has now different kind of trace solutions, I might say. There is the A cores in this case have attached to the Cortex-A and so-called embedded trace macro cell. And you see here, there is an I, D, or C, which is instruction, code, or data. And one of those trace mechanisms you can utilize to have an insight into your core. However, I think we are interested in a kind of a system-wide tracing mechanism, right? We would like to see what's going on all the cores and how are these cores intercommunicating with each other. So therefore, we are currently preparing our prototypes into the direction of this so-called STM tracing, which is the system macro cell. That means it's a similar kind of approach than to the tricore approach, where you write one specific variable into an outside memory and everybody can write to it. It's a bit similar. The system trace macro cell is an own memory address range where all the cores can write to. And this address range triggers the hardware trace features when you write to it. But it gives you way more than just these two features. You also get by the system trace macro cell who has written to it. That means you get which core was writing to it. You also get 64K different trace channels. So you can basically distribute the trace information to 64K channels in order to split up where the source was coming from, which is also kind of a nice feature. So summing up, the system trace macro cell is kind of a null memory. That means the writing to this memory triggers the hardware trace message. Only the write access to it introduces the overhead, but you would not need to add an actual process for that. As soon as your memory management unit is configured, that you're able to write to this, you can write to this from every application level. That's what we're going to see on the next page. And as already said, the system trace memory is available for all cores and handles a centralized timestamping, which is also kind of a nice feature. So you can directly correlate the runtime execution of all the cores, even if they change the frequencies. There are kind of similar trace macro cells available. There's also an instrumentation trace macro cell. So they kind of differ between the different hardware architectures. But summing up, tracing can be pretty efficiently used if you use one of those data trace based solutions. How does this look actually for an adaptive system? Switching to the next slide, the ARM-based trace support needs to be available for each so-called exception level, right? So the virtual machine, or if it's a hypervisor or any hardware differentiation between the exception levels, needs to be able to write to it. So that means also the OS shall be able to write to it, which is for us really helpful that you can combine here OS measurement and also adaptive application measurement. By doing this, you make the OS write to the hardware memory of the system trace macro cell and the adaptive application write to the system trace macro cell. With that approach, each exception level is writing to it, and each core is writing to it. And now, moving this a step further, imagine you have an Renaissance or any other ARM-based processor who has a classic platform running on it and an adaptive platform. Then you make each trace point write to the system macro cell. even if it's for classic platform, the OS, the virtual functional bus trace hooks, all of them write to the system macro cell, and the POSIX OS in this case for the adaptive application and the RLock or the adaptive application. That means everybody can write to it with on this by writing to the same hardware address. And the you don't need to take care about synchronizing it because the hardware access is arbitrated by the memory access and the timestamping, the message procedure, everything is done by hardware. So you don't need to care about anything, which is, I think, quite nice. So the trace tool afterwards captures the measurement stream, stores it in a trace, and currently forwards it to our TA2 suite adaptive prototype. If you're interested in such kind of a demo, just let us know at a later point. Now, how's the toolchain actually look, right? What needs to be done in order to get this message out of that hardware ECU? The demonstrator currently looks like this. There is a Linux OS with Microsoft Adaptive running on it. There's also a classic platform, by the way, running on one of the M cores. There is an iSystem trace debugger who captures the system trace macro cell trace stream. And there is a CSV lock storage where we just simply store those system trace stream events. That means whenever one of the classic or adaptive cores writes to it, it will be extracted. iSystem stores it for us in the CSV, and we can again relate scheduling decisions on adaptive and classic against to each other, and we can check this again through the requirements. But additionally, as we saw on the first slide, on the slide before, you can also store additional information like an RLock message, which is, I think, quite an interesting feature. So that was it from the trace techniques and the background motivation. I'm handing over to Florian.
Okay, very good. Thank you. Then give me a second to share my screen again. And so you should be able to see my screen now. What I have here opened up is the start point where you get into the Timing Architects tool suite. You will see there which kind of option you have activated. The TA2 suite offers three options that can be activated optional and additionally. So there's a base part of the TA2 suite that you will always need since it contains all the editor actions and editing information. Then we have the TA design and simulation. These two can be used in very early stages to have a static overview on your software design inside the ECU. You will be able to see different tasks, runnables, and the interactions with each other in the option design. And once you have the runtime information available, you will also be able to simulate the dynamic behavior of the ECU with TA simulation in early stages of the project without actually having a hardware available and just running simulations without deploying your ECU to the actual hardware at this point in time. The TA inspection can then be used in later stages of the project. When you have such scheduling traces available that can be recorded as described by Sebastian in the last couple of minutes and can be analyzed there. Here you can select different workspaces. I have here one workspace for demonstration purposes where are yeah, and inside there are some projects pre-prepared that I will show you to now. So now we see the TA tool suite itself. You can see here on the left side a model selector. So here you have all the different models and all the different projects that you're working on. On the right top side, you can see the different options of the Timing Architects tool suite. Again, the editing part, this is the TA base, design, simulation, and inspection, and you can switch between these different options of the tool. So now, as a first step, let's stay with the tracing, and let's consider we have now extracted a BTF trace as described by Sebastian earlier. What can you do with such a trace, and how do you work with such a trace in TA? We have here prepared a trace, a BTF trace, and this trace now shows you what I have also described in the early stages of this presentation. You can see what happened to which task at which point in time. So here you can see, for example, the task 2 milliseconds is changing its state to activated and so on. So it's a quite a long log file here. And in order to get this into TA, what you can do is you simply right click here, select the import, and now you go down to trace import, select BTF trace import, and just go ahead and search for this file. So we are here in the 5 trace import and select this BTF file. Okay. Now you need to select where to store your trace. So it's obviously this BTF project, and the model name is here now BTF trace import. So it's an automatic name. And we can rename it to embedded meetup. Okay. So next, it will allow you to apply some levels of error checking. We will not do a check here since we know that it will be working. Now you can see here on the bottom right that the trace import is currently loading. And as soon as this is at 100%, we will see a message if it was successful or not successful. If there have been any errors, you would get a report of the errors and can also check what has been the issue in this trace. Maybe there were some transitions not measured correctly. Now, automatically with this import, there has been a model generated based on the trace. And this is what you can see in the base part of the tooling. So you can see the different tasks in here now, but that's not really interesting right now. We will get to that in a later point in time when we come to an AutoSAR model and when we come to simulating with the TA tool suite. For tracing, we will then switch to the inspection in a minute. What I have prepared here, what you can do in this model is you can define requirements. We have prepared here a bunch of requirements that will be checked by the inspection once we run an evaluation. But I want to show you what's contained in this kind of requirements. So what you see here, you have the possibility to define requirements on different levels. You can define requirements, for example, on processes, on runnables, and also you could define event chains, what I was talking about earlier in the beginning with this example of 3 tasks which read sensor data, process them, and do an action based on this. For now, to keep it simple, we have here just a bunch of process requirements. So here we have defined deadlines for the different tasks. These tasks shown here are periodically scheduled tasks, which have now a requirement for a response time. And we have also defined some deadlines for other tasks. Now all with the severity critical, but you would also have the possibility to distinguish between different severity levels up here. And adding new requirements is actually quite easy. You would simply select the task that you're interested in right here. Select the requirement that you want to check, so activate to activate, lower or upper limit, and add different severity levels to this one. Okay, now we already have some requirements in here. Let's move to the inspection part of the tool and let's have a look at how such a evaluation based on trace combined with requirements looks like. If you have just imported the trace, as I did until now, all you can see is basically here a Gantt chart. So what we show here is you can see on the left side the different cores that are available in the system. So it's two cores, core one and core two. And you can see on the right side all the different tasks that are inside this trace. And now you see, okay, this trace is 2 seconds long, and you will now be able to see inside this trace, once we zoom in, all the different activations, preemptions, and running states of the different tasks. Sorry. Let's now have a look at the Gantt chart. What do the different colors mean? You can always see these gray arrows here. These gray arrows indicate activation. So at this point in time, this task input processing was activated. With the gray state, it's indicated that this task was active, but it was not running since there was another task running on this core with a higher priority. And what you can see here is basically that when the task input processing was activated, there was the task 1 millisecond running on this core at the moment, and that's why we have a start delay here. Afterwards, it's getting in the state of running, and here it gets terminated again. Moving on to this 2 millisecond tasks, you notice here that you see it's activated, and it actually starts running for 150 microseconds directly. But then we see this light green area, and in this state, the the task 2 milliseconds was preempted here by the writing actuator. This is what the different colors mean in this Gantt chart. Now, yeah, that's nice. We can scroll through it and we can see what happened here. But of course, it's more interesting to work with the requirements that we have defined. So let's now start an evaluation here on the bottom left. You will now get a new evaluation. It's named with a timestamp in this case, but you can also choose your individual name. Now we select the requirements that we want to evaluate. We define which kind of metrics we want this evaluation to calculate. So we will calculate in this case the metrics for hardware resources for the CPU load, and we will now calculate the processes in the table and in the histogram. And here we also get the chance to select the requirements and load calculation. We will also activate this in the table and in the Gantt chart. Now let's run this evaluation. It will take a couple of seconds, and now we see the result of this evaluation. Now we get some additional information. Here, first of all, we can see a load chart, which indicates we have a pretty high load. If we want to have a first general overview about the resource consumption of the system, what you can do is open the hardware resource table, and now you can see in an overview the resource consumption of the overall ECU, which is at 74% here, and we can see the resource consumption of the different cores. Now let's move in the next step to the requirements that we have created earlier and that we can see now here. What you see here is green, of course, there's no violation, so the requirement was kept in this case. If it's red, then you can see that the requirement was violated. And what we see here is, let's have a look at this guy at the 1 millisecond task. We can see the requirement for this task was that we want to have a response time, and the limit for the response time is one millisecond. And we see that this event occurred 2000 times within this measured trace. And in 128 cases, it's violated this requirement. Now, this is what you can also have in a report, by the way, to which we will get in a minute. But let's consider now we have seen the report and we get this information about the violation. And we want now to go into more detail and understand what was actually happening at this point in time when the violation happened. What I'm doing now, I drag and drop this requirement into the Gantt chart. And what you see now is here that now we have some red arrows in here. These red arrows always indicate the requirements violation. And interesting thing about that, you can scroll around, you can have a look at the different requirements violations and try to find out what happened here. If you want to see who interfered with your task so that you had such a long start delay in this case, causing your task to be delayed, and in the end violate this deadline requirement, you can activate here on the top right the interference view. If we do this, this trace gets re-evaluated, takes some seconds here, and now we can see these red lines all over in the trace. And this indicates every time a task has been interfering with another task, causing preemptions like here. So we see this task was running, but it was preempted and it started again to run. And also here with this task 1 millisecond that we have been looking at, we see it was activated. And then here we had this interference with this input processing task. Of course, it doesn't make really much fun to scroll around and have a look at each and every individual deadline violation here, because most probably you would be interested in the outliers. So in the cases where you had the most violation of this deadline. So you can also simply open a histogram and drag and drop this requirement into the histogram. And now you can see all these 2000 instances that happened, and you can actually see that quite a lot of them here had a very short response time, actually, of around about 0.5 milliseconds. And we can see here the deadline. So everything on the left fulfilled the requirement. And here on the right side, we can actually see all the instances that violated this requirement. And now we would start to investigate the outliers, the most extreme cases where we had the longest response time causing this deadline violation. So you can simply mark them in the Gantt chart. You click right, send this selection to the clipboard, and now you can see here below in the clipboard every instance of the 1 millisecond tasks who have violated this deadline requirement. And now if you double click on this, you directly jump to the point in time in the Gantt chart where this violation happened, and you can now investigate all these outliers, all these extreme cases. And from there, you can now start thinking about different solutions, aligning offsets, maybe could help, or maybe you see that it could be an idea to map this task to a different core or split it up and so on. You can develop different ideas based on this analysis on how to improve your system to avoid this kind of requirements violation. Now, I was talking earlier about having all these kind of informations contained in the report. This is also possible here in the TA2 suite. We have the report functionality there. And we will now generate an evaluation report for this BTF trace. So let's go here, the BTF trace. We need to select this evaluation that we have done. This is this one with timestamp from a couple of minutes ago. You could have a report configuration file. So if the report is a HTML report, you can completely customize it. So if you have a configuration available that you want to use for all your reports, you can select it here. So let's assume now we don't have anything prepared. Now you can here in the next part of this configuration select which kind of information you want to have in this report. So you have the processing units, you have the processes, runnable groups if you have done some. So this is also a very nice feature. You would have the possibility to group runnables from different applications together and give them a name. For example, for basic software, runnables that are from the basic software, you could group them and name them basic software tasks or runnables. And then you would have this runnable group evaluated separately and get information about this. Yeah, let's just select the hardware resource and process requirements now in this case. And we want to use the default template in this example. And we now select the place where we are going to store this kind of information. Let's put it here in the BTF. We create a new folder for this, which we call report. And select the folder and finish. Now the report has been successfully generated and we will jump to this path. We have here the report folder and now you have this report available and you can have a look at it. And you will now be informed what you have seen in the tool as well. The deadline of the task 1 millisecond was violated. You can see the resource consumption in the different cores, and you can also see some statistics that are of course also configurable. So you will see the activate to activate time between these different tasks in this case and so on. Okay, so much about the reporting. I mean, the benefit of this report is of course we will come to automatization in a later step of this webinar. If you have this completely automatized, what you can do is simply run this workflow over and over again with every build that you do and get this kind of report, depending on how often you build, daily, weekly, and have an instant feedback of how your requirements are behaving and how the changes that you did in this build have affected the dynamic behavior of your ECU. And that without even opening the tool. So you can inform the different stakeholders that are working on this project. And only if there is everything green, okay, everything's fine. No one needs to investigate. And if there are violations that you would like to have a closer look at, then you jump back to the inspection and do this kind of analysis that I have shown to you before. Okay, now so much about the TA inspection. And now I would like to give you a brief overview what you can do. First of all, without having any input available. So if you just want to model from scratch and design your scheduling. And later I will also show you how you can import AutoSAR files into this to get a model out of your ECUC and system description. So first of all, about the modeling from scratch. What you can do is you can create a new timing model in the TA tool suite. So we will create a new project, embedded meetup. And inside this, we will have a new tiling model now. My model. You can now select the number of cores. Let's consider we have two cores. And let's keep it easy. We have three runnables with three processes, three tasks with two runnables in each of the processes. Okay, now the TA Tool Suite has created for us a new model, MyTAM. We move to the editing part, and we can now see here we have the different tasks, we have the different runnables, and you can define for the different runnables, for example, also different runtimes. In this case, there have been some instructions included with 70 nanoseconds. Let's say we want to have in here some additional information so that once we simulate, we already have some kind of runtimes in there. So we can add now just as an example to one of these tasks. Let's say it's running for 0.2 milliseconds. And we save this model and we switch directly to the simulation in this case. Now we also go to start, and you will recognize a lot from what we have seen so far in the inspection as well. So we will see basically the same user interface that you know from inspection. The main difference between simulation and inspection is simply that the inspection is working based on an actual measured scheduling trace, and the simulation is simply simulating this behavior in this part of the tool. So now we see we have the two cores, we have these tasks that are configured automatically by the TA Tool Suite in our model, and we can see that all these tasks are actually activated in the same point in time. So this indicates we didn't set up any offsets yet, and this results here in the fact that here this first task is actually starting to run on the core one, and until this is finished, the other tasks will not get any time to actually run in on this core. So that's, I hope this gives you a basic idea of how you can start modeling from scratch and how to go take it from there and start to plan a scheduling for a project without any inputs. Let's move from there to importing from an AUTOSAR model. If we have some AUTOSAR files available, it's possible to import these files directly into the Timing Architects tool suite. So we have here prepared the system description and ECU configuration, and we will now in the next step import this into the TA Tool Suite to again get a model of this project. What you do for that is you right click, you import, and now this time we want to import a timing model. We select the AUTOSAR system description and ECU configuration import. We move to the directory where we have stored this kind of input, model import, AUTOSAR, and we select these two files. Okay. And we go for the same folder here again, and we will see a model generated based on this on these configuration files in a minute or a couple of seconds. Okay, now we see again we have a Timing Architects model based on this AUTOSAR import that we have done. We can now also see all the different tasks in this system. We can now as well see in on a runnable level. We can see the different accesses, sender receiver accesses in this case, in this example. And we can also see some information on runtime here already. And based on this input, if you have this from your AutoSAR projects, what you can do at this point in time is you can now use the design and simulation option. Design option here allows you to analyze in a static way how the interactions between the different tasks and runnables are. So all these arrows indicate that you have here accesses between the different tasks. And what this helps you with, if you have no idea in the beginning whether it makes sense to split up different tasks to different cores, for example, you can have a look at this in a statical way and see which of the tasks do actually have interaction with each other, which gives you a good indication whether it makes sense to split them up to different cores or not. Because if they have a lot of communication ongoing with each other, most likely it doesn't make much sense because you get a lot of cross-core communication overheads by splitting them up, because they're always trying to communicate with each other. So that's one idea about that. And you can define design constraints based on this. So you can define that the task 5 millisecond, task 10 millisecond, for example, need to be on the same core all the time. And this can then be checked automatically also by the tier 2 suite, whether this design constraint has been kept or not. Another thing that you can show in this communication graph, I think you remember my example of the three tasks that need to be executed in order: read, process sensor data, and do an action based on this. You can define event chains for that. And these event chains can be shown in the TA design with these green arrows. I will just select and deselect them. So you can see that we have here some event chains that are ongoing between these different tasks and runnables. And you can give such an event chain a certain deadline that it needs to keep, so that you can ensure that this event chain keeps this deadline based on simulation or based on inspection, so that you can evaluate this. Jumping now to simulation, let's just simulate this model so that we get an idea about that. We also select some the hardware resource information here. And now, again, after running this simulation, we have again our Gantt chart. We can have a look at it. We see again there is no offsets selected here. Everyone is activated at the same point in time, resulting in a long waiting time for the different tasks. And we can also see now here on a resource level what's the resource consumption on the different cores. Okay, now we were talking about having this kind of information imported from the AutoSAR project, from the ECUC and system description. ECUC and system descriptions naturally don't really include any runtimes, so you would need to get runtimes from somewhere. And as we have heard before in this webinar, there are different possibilities to gather such runtimes. You can use the runtime measurement module in the AutoSAR stack to get runtime information and import them there. You have the possibility, if you have no information at all available, to just apply some budgets in the beginning to plan your scheduling. But of course, you can incrementally increase the precision of your simulation by have more exact runtimes available. And what you can do for this is, once you have a scheduling trace measured and recorded from the hardware, you will be able to extract the runtimes from this trace. So I'm going now back to our trace that we have imported before and that we have evaluated. And if we right click on this trace, you have the option to extract runtimes from the evaluation. And if you select this now, you have the possibility to select, first of all, what kind of metric for the different runtimes you want to have. Do you want to have the netto execution time? Do you want to have the gross execution time? And you can also decide if you want to have constant instructions or if you want to have a uniform or bell-shaped instructions, for example, that will then be applied by the simulation. So, for example, what you could have here now is the netto execution times as min, max, and average for based on this trace, and you can then use this in the next step to do a simulation. Now, I have been talking a lot about using the simulation in early phases, so simulation and design in early phases of the project, and the inspection in late phases of the project when you're on the hardware and you want to verify the behavior of your ECU. We also recognized that in the inspection with the requirements, we may notice some violations of requirements, which makes it necessary to do changes to your ECU configuration. And the different ideas that you develop throughout this process where you analyze and think about, okay, maybe I can align the offsets, maybe I can map some runnables to another task, maybe I can have the task on a different core, and so on. You will come up with a bunch of different ideas. And changing these or bringing these ideas to the hardware by changing the configuration and getting executable that you can flash to your ECU and where you can record new trace measurements and evaluating them again, since you need to make a new build and so on, this can take quite some time. And here you can highly benefit from using a simulation also in these late stages by, instead of bringing everything to the hardware, just testing out your different ideas on how to improve the system by using the simulation, because the simulation allows you very, very easily, if we go back to the editing of our AutoSAR model that we had, you are very easily enabled to do some changes when it comes to the timing, for example. So you would be able now, for example, let's assume we know that for this runnable, we have some additional customer requirements. They want to have some additional features that you need to implement. And most probably, this will cause some additional runtime overhead. And yes, of course, now you can implement it and you can just check in the end and notice that you have that this takes too much time and that your system doesn't work anymore. But what would be a better way is if you estimate how long this additional feature will increase the runtime of your runnable and then simply test out what happens to your system by simply adding, for example, additional runtime of, let's say, whatever, 200 microseconds. Save it, switch back to simulation, start the simulation again, and then you already see within minutes what kind of effect this increase in runtime will have for your overall system. So, for example, now you will be able to see that now we will have a higher CPU load compared to what we have with the simulation that we have done previously. This helps to find out about such impacts very early without having the necessity to bring everything down to an actual hardware. You just go with different ideas, simulate them, and you just bring the idea to the hardware and verify it. That sounds most or not sounds, but that seems to be most promising based on the simulation. Okay, so that's all for the two things that we promised for today. First of all, evaluation of timing related requirements based on the scheduling trace. And now we also heard about prediction of the real-time behavior based on a simulation. I will now hand over again to Sebastian for the last part of this webinar, which is how to automatize this all these steps that I have shown to you and have them in an automatized way, also integrated into your CI environments.
Hi, thank you, Florian. I hope my screen is visible in the moment.
Yes.
Thanks. Yeah, exactly. So Florian told us about the evaluation of timing related requirements and the prediction. You can do both of them, but ideally you can also automatize them. You can automatize both in order for you to make things easier. Having a look at the evaluation topic first. Imagine you do a measurement, trace measurement, and you would like to get as close as possible to any situation happening in the car. Then you could set up a measurement platform, which is automatized in, for example, post-build in your build process. An idea. If you want to measure the ECU ecosystem in its natural environment, that means you want to automatize that the ECU is tested with your functional tests, then you can utilize Canoe to send proper CAN messages to the ECU, which makes the ECU actually respond to switching on a light, opening a door, or accelerating the car. In the meantime, sharpen the trace debugger in order to record what the ECU is doing. So you directly see effects of different scenarios resulting on the ECU measurement. Right? With this approach, you can also kind of get an experience how the ECU behaves in stress test situations. And afterwards, the trace can be stored and you can export a report for internal stakeholders. As Florian told us already with the requirements, green, red for the management, for example, or customer reports. So you can document to the customers, see there's still enough space for features, even if we are in a high load situation, and so on. One idea for automatization. But nevertheless, you don't need to automatize only trace measurement. You can also apply the prediction use case within the tool for an automatized use case. Therefore, I'm going to switch to the TA tool in order to explain you how this automatization is working. I hope you see now my TA2 suite instance. You can see in the middle, there's the so-called workflow editor. The idea of this workflow editor is each manual step you click in the GUI by, for example, importing something, auto system description, ECU configuration, for example, starting a simulation, evaluating against requirements, creating a report. Each of those steps is a step in a workflow. And this is why we call this automation use case workflow. So we have here certain so-called job nodes, which is one of those boxes, and you can connect them manually. How would it look like? You can load a file by simply drag and drop it into this area. Then afterwards, you want to feed it to the AutoSAR import, right? So the file would be then our AutoSAR files. You connect them and the connection is established. Now, configure the load files to load your AR/XML files by opening a Windows Explorer and afterwards saving, for example, the timing model. So I have added now, loading all the files, processing them to a TA model, and save the timing model. I'm going to delete this one, this example files, because I've already prepared something for you. This is a workflow which simply does an evaluation. And it already loads the evaluation, loads the template report file, so you can customize the templates of your report HTML files and save them to a directory. So what we are going to see now is, after I have started the workflow, you will see that those jobs are executed and they are providing us, in the workspace folder I am, an example report. Let's have a look. I execute the workflow. You see it runs through, was quite fast. Everything finished. That's it. There's a new folder opened, which is this report with the timestamp. Let's have a look what's in the report. It's the standard report, which indicates the report creation date, which is Saturday. For me, it's 9 o'clock. And then it's the requirements violations, CPU load overview, but showing you the additional features so you can extend it with also other information like stack usage, RAM usage, or ROM usage. You can add a lot of information to the outside world in order to map it to your resource requirements on the runtime behavior. Here you find the process metrics for each task with cross-execution time, CPU load, as we saw before. And ideally, we can also find a runnable group in this case. You see here, there's a runnable group which is called basic software and application software. It goes by a ridiculously amount of 2.96% of load. This is just because it's a very simple demo model which does basically nothing, but I think you get the idea. So all those schedulable main functions have been grouped together. So far, so good. You've seen this feature already by the presentation by Florian. Now, this can also be automatized in a further step. So you can either set it up everything here, trigger it from the tool. You can start simulation, create reports, feed the information to the different models, merge AutoSAR import files with runtimes, and so on. You can also equip trace measurements with more architectural information from the AutoSAR import, like software components, and so on. So you're quite flexible by simply connecting all of the boxes together, which can be connected together. However, if you set it up once, it's pretty easy to trigger it also from a higher level automation toolchain, like Jenkins. This is my Jenkins workspace. It's called TA Inspector Workflow. And it simply evaluates a trace, creates a report, and now it just doesn't only create an HTML report, but it creates a JUnit report, which is basically a test report. And you see here on the right-hand side how much of the requirements which were evaluated on the trace measurement, while the ECU was measured during a certain driving scenario, for example, have been violated. That means you can directly see with each build and test process how your system reacts and responds. With that approach, you're really good to go in order to determine the current system state throughout the whole development phases. Let's have a look. Let's build now. Build will be scheduled. Okay, it's running. We can also see that it's doing something. Okay, there's some outside. Finished, unstable. What does this mean? Let's have a look at the test result. Test result says there were checks upon CPU load, and now you see there was a test failure which violated the CPU load of core zero. good indication, actually, in order to understand after the build if something has broken your configuration in the sense that you are not intending to continue like this. You can now go into a little bit more detail. So typically in this Jenkins use case, you have not to do anything with the tool itself. The tool is used in the back and the backend in order to produce the data and feed it to your higher level test system. But now you want to go a little bit more deeper, right? You would now want to see what was the error, and that's quite easy because you can then go back into the tool and simply open the workspace that Jenkins was working on. And you will be prompted with the information what was actually the failure. With that approach, you can automatize things from the design phase, for example, the simulation following the DaVinci project, or in a later state, in the verification phase, when you adding new features, components into the different tasks of your ECU. That was everything upon optimization. Thank you very much for your attention, and I'm going to switch back to Florian.
Can you just show the presentation for the last slide?
Yeah,
I think that's easier. Then we don't need to switch again.
Exactly. So, thanks.
Thanks for being here and having us here today. It's been an honor talking to you guys. Or actually, yeah, we've just been talking. We will be there for some more time. If you have any additional questions, you can post them in the chat directly, and we will be there to answer them. And just give you some time to think about questions and post them. In the meanwhile, I have this last slide of this presentation showing you which kind of possibilities you have if you're interested to apply such a solution to your projects. First of all, we would have so-called timing bundles available, which describe the process of integrating such a tracing solution within MicroSAR projects. So it contains a guideline and also examples on how to integrate scheduling traces from configuring the OS and VFB hooks in the DaVinci configurator, how to configure the debugger, and also how to analyze this trace in the Timing Architects tool suite that we have shown you before. This kind of bundle and guideline is available for the debugger solution of iSystem and also for Lauterbach, so for WinIDEA and for Trace32. Let me know, and we can send this out to you directly. Then another possibility, if you would like to test the capabilities of the Timing Architects tool suite that we have shown you today, there's the possibility to get a free test installation of all the options that we have shown today. Just also get in touch. You can get these installations for free for a couple of weeks. And of course, there will be also people available to give you guidance throughout this test installation phase. So for example, we will definitely do a kickoff meeting to help you set up your workspace based on your real project that you're using. And throughout the period of the test installation, we will organize regular meetings with you to help you integrate this solution in your dedicated project. And of course, anytime you have any questions, you can reach out via phone or mail. How can you get this? You can either simply send a mail to embedded@vector.com. Then we will get back in touch with you. You have the possibility to scan this QR code on the right. That will open up a mail that you can send out immediately. Just input your contact data so that we can reach out to you. Or if you prefer LinkedIn, You can see the link to my profile and also a QR code to my profile there. You can also reach out anytime to me directly if you prefer to be in contact via LinkedIn. Okay, then we have a couple of questions. The first is, did not get if the simulation automatization can be included. If not, how it can be possible that we can measure the CPU load with all applications running?
Yes, that's a very good question. The simulation can be included into the automatization. That's possible via the workflow. So you trigger an automatization from the workflow. And the workflow contains a job node, which is basically the simulation, the orders are import, the model creation, depends on your needs in this case. Now, to the second part, if not, how can it be possible so that we can measure full CPU load with application running? Well, since it's applicable, you can therefore measure the complete CPU load. Sometimes you might miss information from the auditor, right? If you don't have the proper model available, then you can either add this via an own timing architects modeling files, or you can add it in any other proprietary comma separated value description. There are ways to do this. We can always discuss this in detail. Short answer to your question, the simulation can be automatized and it includes the complete CPU load if you include the complete Odyssey project. Okay, next question from Ahmed. Is the TIA suite integratable vector solutions as VTest Studio? It is. You can either start tests from there, but it depends if you would like to map requirement IDs, test cases to each other. We have not implemented a current workflow where you can directly map a test case to a TIA tool suite. We can discuss this also in detail, how you can feed your test environment with traceability from the beginning to the end on your VTest Studio project, depending on your needs for VTest Studio. So therefore, Ahmed, I would like to ask you to write us in a later step again so we can directly see what you would like to do with the VTest Studio. Okay, there's another question by Klaus. Is the TIA suite already full usable for adaptive platform? If yes, how do you handle multi-threaded adaptive applications? So currently, the TIA tool suite for adaptive platforms is in a prototype state. We are very happy to give you a demo, an overview about this prototype. And now, how do you handle multi-threaded adaptive applications? That's currently possible with this tracing approach shown in the pretty earlier part of the adaptive tracing slides when we instrument the Linux or could be another OS trace point, for example, if you have QNX or so. If you instrument the OS with those scheduling measurements, so the OS indicates the process switches to the system trace macro cell in the ARM architecture, then the prototype currently suits this approach. Therefore, Klaus, we would need to have a look at which OS you're using, which ECU you're using, and then we can answer the question if the prototype fits your needs. Therefore, I would also like you to write us a mail so we can have a closer look at this. Currently, the answer is yes for a Linux OS, for a Microsoft Adaptive Platform, and for a Renesas processor. Any other questions? Or are there any questions on the questions before, any follow-up questions?
Okay. I don't think so. It's quiet in the chat. And yeah, I think, yeah, some of you guys want to start the weekend. yeah. Then I would say, yeah, we close this stream for today. I want to thank you all for your attention and for being there. And yeah, if any questions come up afterwards, you have the possibility to reach out to us via the mail or the QR codes included in this presentation anytime, and we will be happy to answer your questions and help you with the questions that you have.
So thank you very much also from my side, especially also a great thank you for your attendance, especially on this Saturday and at this point in time. I really appreciate it. If you have any valuable input, just, yeah, as Florian said, contact us. Thank you. And thanks also for Embedded Meetup for making this possible.